Gerusalemme, I khayalami.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Olageni Diekolola Daniels, popularly known as Dieko Spectre, and this is another episode of Dieko Talks Law. And on today's episode, we are talking about legal method. Yes, legal method. And a lot of my friends have told me, especially those in year one in University of Lagos as well as other universities, told me to talk about legal method because most of the time they don't even know what they are doing. You know, you don't know how to study, you know, the parts that, you know, the lecturer tell them to study and all that. So basically, this is going to be like an introduction video, but today I'm going to be talking about natural law, but then I'm going to be introducing a lot of things, so I'm going to make it as simple as possible so that someone who is in year one or who is studying law for the first time, which is what you know is presumable because it's legal method, so basically you're studying law for the first time in University of Lagos, what you do would be English, poetry, which is under English, sociology, psychology, political science and the rest. But legal method is different because, you know, is law in code. So what are the things to look out for, what are the things to note and all that. So I'm going to be discussing natural law as a theory of law under legal methods. Natural law as a theory of law under legal methods. So basically we are going to be talking about the history. We are going to be talking about the meaning. We are going to be talking about the philosophers of natural law. We are going to be talking about examples of law that are currently extant in Nigeria, which depict natural law. Then we are going to be talking about the cases. The cases are going to be numerous, as well as the criticism, which is going to be the last part of it. So this video is going to be divided into part A and part B. So this is part A part, obviously, and then we're going to have the part B subsequently. So let us start with the history of natural law. The first thing first is that we don't know where natural law started. Now, if we're going to the meaning of natural law, you will know that natural law is basically the law of God. Do you understand? Natural law is basically the law of God. Now, when we look at it from the angle that natural law is the law of God, then you see that when you're talking about the history, then you're supposed to talk about the existence of God, which nobody can talk about. So the only part we can start talking about natural law is from Adam and Eve. Do you understand? So when you're talking about natural law, we are basically talking about the law of God, the law of conscience. Do you understand? The law of nature, in quotes. The fact that you are supposed to be reasonable. The fact that you are supposed to be just. The fact that you are supposed to be fair, that is everything that natural law entails. Fairness, just, reasonability, and everything that has to do with good conscience. So let us talk about the history now, especially in relation to Adam and Eve, which is where we can pinpoint natural law to be. So I don't know how many of my viewers are Christians, but I don't know the Muslim version of it. But I believe that you guys have, at least for Christians, you have like knowledge of how Adam and Eve came about and how they left the Garden of Eden. I went to school. Okay, moving on. When Adam and Eve were in the Garden of Eden, God made a law. Now, God said, you can take out of every fruit in the garden. However, you should not take out of this particular tree, which is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Or something like that, but you understand what I'm talking about. Take out of every fruit, but don't take out of this particular tree. Okay, quite all right. Now, God went back upstairs, presumably heaven, and Adam went to work, or he wasn't at home, sha, and Eve was at home, in quotes, and there was snake. And then the snake came to meet Eve and told Eve about the fruit and said, "Don't mind God, God is this, God is that. He knows that when you eat it, you'll be as knowledgeable as he is, blah blah blah." Eve decided to eat it. And then when Adam came, Eve told Adam, and all that, and all that, and all that, Adam ate it. Very good. God was watching them. God saw everything. We all know that God is the, you know, all knowing and all, you know, omnipotent, omniscience, omni everything. Now, when God decided to come downstairs, said, okay, let me check out my guys downstairs. He decided to come down, and then when he got down, he saw that Adam and Eve were hiding. So basically, when they ate from the fruit of the knowledge of good and bad, or good and evil, or something like that, they realized that they were naked. Do you understand? And then they went to take leaves to cover themselves so that God would not see them naked, in quotes. Now, God realized that they were hiding, and then God knew what they had done. But God still asked them, what did you do? Do you understand? God still asks them, what did you do? That is, he wants them to explain. And then after explaining, he still asks them, why did you do it? So when he asked Adam, Adam, what did you do? Adam said, I ate out of the tree. Then now asked him, why did you do it? He said, it was the woman which you gave to me that, you know, made me eat it. Then God went to the woman. What did you do? She said she ate out of the fruit. And then he asked again, why did you do it? She said it was the serpent. Then God went to meet the serpent. You know, what did you do and why did you do it and all that. This is just to paint to you that God knew what had happened, and yet God, out of fairness, justice, and good conscience, decided to ask again, what did you do? That's exactly how natural law works. When you are talking about natural law, you are saying that a law should not be draconian. A law should not be against humanity, against mankind. Do you understand? So what I just explained to you about God and, you know, the serpent, Adam and Eve, is, you know, what we know today as the principle of Odi Utrem Patem, which is hear the other side. Odi Utrem Patem. And also the principle of Nemo Judes in Kawasa Swa. Both principles are enshrined in section 36 of the Constitution, which means that no matter what happens, no law, you cannot make a law in Nigeria that will take away you hearing another party. Do you understand? That's why there is the establishment of courts, and then courts must always hear the both sides. So I'm just trying to explain to you that when you are referring to natural law in existence, you are saying that natural law is everything that has to do with the laws of God. And what are the laws of God? The law of fairness, the law of justice, the law of good conscience. Do you understand? Once you understand this as the background knowledge, we are still going to look at the philosophers and what each of those philosophers said. Do you understand? And how, you know, the whole, I'm not going to go deep into how the whole natural law started and all the whole Aristotle and this and that. I just want you to understand how it operates in Nigeria, which is, you know, what is important when you are talking about legal methods, how it operates, the natural law operates in Nigeria. So basically, we already know the history, and I told you that we cannot find exactly where natural law, you know, came from, because since it's the law of God, then you have to look at the existence of God. But we can talk about Adam and Eve, and then we can talk about the law there that, you know, illustrates to us what exactly natural law, you know, should be. And then we already know the meaning of natural law. Now let us go to the philosophers of natural law. So we are supposed to be talking about the philosophers of natural law. So by philosophers, we are saying that those that defined natural law according to their own perspective and their elements, or what they think, you know, should be the definition of natural law, in quotes. So the first person we are going to be talking about is Cicero. That's Marcus Cicero. So when we are talking about Marcus Cicero, he said that natural law is the true law, and that natural law is the right reason in agreement with nature. Natural law is the true law, and natural law is the right reason in agreement with nature. So which means that According to him, no other law is better than natural law, in quotes. And we already, you know, define natural law, or we already have an understanding of what natural law is. That is, that natural law is, you know, a law that is fair, that is just, that is equitable, and all that. So according to Marcus Cicero as well, he opined that natural law cannot be abolished, or it is unchangeable and it applies universally. So when you're talking about natural law being not abolished, in quotes, you can't abolish natural law, and then you cannot change natural law. And that is quite true, because I told you that the history of natural law dates as far back as the creation of man. And so if they were to change it, or they were to abolish it, it should have been abolished before now. But natural law still applies, even in our constitution, in section 33 to section 45 of the 1999 constitution. You are going to find entrenched in it the fundamental human rights, from right to life, right to personal liberty, right to dignity of human person, right to fair hearing, right to privacy, right to movement, right to this, right to that. You are going to see that the fact that a human being should have certain rights, for example, right to life, that another person should not deprive your right to life, is natural law, and, you know, other rights. And then there's also this question as to whether abortion is a valid law. In our criminal code, it says that, you know, you cannot abort a baby. It criminalizes it, so it's illegal to abort a baby. Now, that you can see that killing a child or killing a fetus, there's a debate that aborting a baby 2 weeks old, 1 month old, is not yet a baby. It's a fetus. It's still like in its formatory stage, and then you cannot say that that is killing, in quotes. But natural law says it's against good conscience for you to take, you know, the life of a child, no matter how little, even if it is 1 hour old. The fact that there is a conception, in quote, shows that there is life. If the doctor can say from the moment of conception there is life, then you can't take that life away. That is what the criminal code says by criminalizing, you know, abortion. So here we are talking about natural law, and then we are saying what is fair and what is just, and then we are saying that according to Cicero, he says natural law is true law, and that it is right reason in agreement with nature. It cannot be abolished, it cannot be changed. And then he also opined that where there is a clash between natural law and positive law, natural law should always prevail. And also, where there is positive law, okay, for those that, you know, are, you know, listening to this for the first time and you basically don't know what positive law is. Positive law is a law regardless of its moral tendencies. So when the philosophers of positive law say that law is law regardless of what people think it is. So, for example, I just want to give an example from the top of my head. Let's say General Sani Abacha. You know, he once said during his own regime that there are certain publications that you should not make, especially when it's against his government. I'm just giving this as an example so that you would understand. So, now, if a journalist makes a publication that is against his government, then that law would, you know, come against that particular publication, and then he would have to either withdraw it or be sentenced or be fined. Now, the question is that law a just law? That restricting someone's freedom of speech to criticize the government, is it a just law? When you are talking about positive law, they do not answer the question of whether or not it's a just law. Law is law so far it has been made from a legitimate backing. So, for example, General Sani Abacha is the head of state, which means he has a legitimate backing. So, with that, any law that he makes, regardless of whether it makes sense or not, to them is law. So, even if he says every child born from January to December 2020 should be killed, according to positive law philosophers, that is law, irrespective of whether the law makes sense. But according to natural law, they are saying that a law must be just to be applicable. Before a law can be said to be applicable in a particular community, that law must be just, it must be fair. So according to Marcus Cicero, where a law has been made, and that law isn't just and not fair, then it should be, it shouldn't be obeyed. The law should not be obeyed. The law should be abolished, because a true law is a law that is just, fair, and in right reason with nature, in right agreement with nature. So it will not be in agreement with nature for a child to be given birth to, and because General Sani Abacha said kill all children, he decided to kill a newborn baby. It will not be in agreement with nature to take away the freedom of speech of a particular person and all that. So let us go to another philosopher. The next philosopher we are going to be talking about now is Thomas Aquinas. And interestingly, Thomas Aquinas said that any law that does not align with the laws of God cannot be regarded, or should not be regarded as a law, and should be discarded, shouldn't be obeyed, and all that. In fact, Thomas Aquinas gave four types of law. He called one eternal law. He said another one is the divine law. Another one is the natural law, and then you have the positive or human-made laws. So let's start with the eternal law. So now, when he was talking about eternal law, he said the laws governing creation made by God is called the eternal law. So for example, you have the law that there must be day and there must be night. That is the eternal law. The laws that every child who is born must one day die. That is eternal law. The law that all fingers are not equal, therefore everybody cannot be equal. One person must be poor while the other is not. One person must be smart while the other is not, and all that. And then you also have the divine law. So now we've talked about the eternal law, we're talking about the divine law. The divine law is just that amongst Christians that has been written down in the Holy Bible. So you have, you must fast, you must pray, you must love your neighbor as yourself, you must, you know, do all those religious things, like things stated in the Bible. You must believe in the Holy Spirit to direct your ways. You must speak in tongues, even though not all churches agree with that. Why some say you have not prayed except you have spoken in tongues, but that one is covered by the divine law. And then you also have the natural law, which according to Thomas Aquinas is the law of reason. Here we are not talking about, according to Thomas Aquinas, you are not in fact talking about God, but you are talking about reason, your head. Does it make sense for you to say that somebody for Sani Abacha to say that he wants to kill every child that will give birth to from January to December? Does it make any reasonable sense? Does it make any sense for Sani Abacha to withdraw someone's freedom of expression? Does it make any sense at all? And so there are like thousands of other examples which are going to be seen in the cases that we are going to be talking about. Principle of here the other side, which is odi otrem patem, nebo judes in chaoses. While you have a lot of other principles, even talking about equity, you know, equity and good conscience. So you have the principle of good conscience as well. All those are, you know, inside natural law. And then you have the last one, which is the positive or human law. Now, positive or human law is saying that where a particular law does not align with the laws of God, does not align with the laws of reason. Do you understand? I already explained to you what positive law. Law is law irrespective of what the moral tendencies are, irrespective of whether or not it aligns with natural law. So when you are talking about positive law, you are saying they have made law. I'm going to discuss more about positive law. I'm just trying to give you like a quick overview of what we're talking about. So when you're talking about positive law, law is law. Do you understand? Irrespective of what you have the Austin's theory of positive law and all that. That's what we're going to be talking about in positive law when I'm talking about that. But when you're talking about natural law, you're saying that for even positive law to be obeyed, it must, you know, meet the tendencies of natural law, the thresholds of natural law. It must align with natural law. Yeah, do you understand? So that is all for Thomas Aquinas, where he distinguished between natural law, eternal law, divine law, and positive law. So let us go to the next philosopher. We have other philosophers. We have John Locke, we have Aristotle, we have Saint Aquinas, we have Hugo Grotius, we have a lot of them. You can, during your personal time, like, look through what they've said and all that, but you just need to have a background knowledge of what natural law is, which is what this video is about. What is just, what is fair, what aligns with the laws of God and all that. We have that at the back of your mind, because we are going to discuss like a lot of cases. So let us talk about the laws that show example of the natural law, which is currently extant, which means which is currently applied in Nigeria today. The first law is the EFCC Act, which is the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission Act. What does it basically say? Don't steal money when you are in a governmental position, number one. Number two, yahoo boys, do not steal money from people abroad. Some days ago, EFCC arrested about two Chinese men who wanted to bribe, EFCC, because they were investigating their company. I think a particular state, I think Sokoto State, between the years of 2015 and 2020, sorry, between the years of 2005 and 2020, they gave them a contract worth 50 billion. Do you understand? Like, I think a series of contracts worth 50 billion. And then they have not, carried out the contract. And then EFCC now started investigating their company for probably divesting money into their personal pocket and all that and all that. And then they now wanted to bribe EFCC people. They wanted to bribe EFCC people by giving them 100 million cool cash, sweet money. Just enter, not I want to transfer to your account too. Cash in Ghana must go. Like, they put the cash on the table like this. Millionaire, if you were the one, what would you do? But then, according to EFCC Sokoto, which is a very good thing for the person heading that particular branch, they decided to arrest them, and that is what that law is talking about: moral conduct. Is it just? Is it reasonable for you to want to defraud a particular person for those being yahoo, or for you to want to be in a particular position and steal? For example, what Abacha did, I'm not calling Abacha a thief, but at least after he died, he's still sending us gifts from heaven. Like, periodically, even this corona time, he still said, Nigeria, people are struggling, take this amount of money. Like, he just gives us, like, take, my dear, take. Do you understand? So I'm not saying he stole it, but the way he gives it to us indirectly is what is still amazing me. You understand what I'm talking about? That is the essence of the whole EFCC Act. And so we also have the Independent Corrupt Practices and other blah blah blah. That's the ICPC Act. And then ICPC Act basically works with the EFCC Act. And then we have the Money Laundering Act. So for those who do not understand what like money laundering in fact is, you just take money that from an illegal thing, put it into a legal thing, and then the money becomes legal. The proceeds of the money becomes legal. Do you understand? So for example, you are a governor. You take money from the central, from your official account, which is the state's official account, and then you put the money in a particular legal business. You realize that the proceeds of that business becomes your own money, or becomes illegal money. That's what it is. Launder. Do you understand? Launder, like washing, laundering. So Money Laundering Act. So that is also illegal. So for example, we have the law of tort. Law of tort is like civil action. Do you understand? I'm trying to break it down, so that you can understand very, very well. Like, because this is like the beginning of most of you guys. So when you're talking about law of tort, I see like a civil action, a civil wrong, been done. So when you're coming to court, you're bringing a civil action. So now, you have battery, you have assault, you have negligence. Those are under law of torts. You have trespass to land, trespass to chattel. So for example, somebody just comes to meet you and then gives you a slap. Hot one. What will you do? You know, for someone like me, first of all, I would want to first understand if you are mad. Do you understand? Mokokofe get no. Are you alright? Then when I determine that this place is correct, I'll change it for you. Oh. But then that's exactly what law of thought is. So when you are talking about law of thought, we are saying that, you know, the law should guide how we interact with each other. We have the criminal perspective, which is the criminal code, and then we have the law of thought, which is the civil perspective. So if a person slaps you, which is going to be an assault, or if a person beats you up, or if a person steals your thing, that those are criminal actions that you can take in the criminal court. However, if you want to take a civil action, which means you don't want the person to go to prison, which is the repercussion of a criminal action, when you take a criminal, you bring a criminal action before the court, that person is going to go to prison. For example, I think assault is about 6 months or something, I can't remember. Sorry, Joe. So, you know, when you bring an action in criminal court, it takes you to prison. But you bring an action in civil court, it gives you money, which is what I advise people to do. The person have slapped you, what is slapping me? Why do you want to see the person locked up? Just except the person is poor. If the person is poor, they're not lock the person up. But if the person has cool cash, like Dangote, just imagine that he just gives me a little bit of tap, just this loved one. Man, that's slap for me because I'm taking you to court. So you just understand what I'm talking about. I'm saying that when you are talking about torts, now is a civil action, and then when you are talking about civil actions, they are brought before, you know, another party, and then the repercussion for a civil action like torts is, you know, fine. So you just pay me money for what the damage that you have done to me. So you have negligence. Negligence is when you are supposed to do something and you did not do it. Probably you negligently, you know, forgot or something. You have the case of Dunno and Stevenson and all that. But let us not go into that. We are trying to talk about natural law. So how does natural law come into thought? It is going to be unfair and unjust for people to be slapping each other up and down. That's the reason why thought has come around. It's going to be unfair and unjust for people to be stealing things. That's the reason why criminal law came. So you have criminal law criminalizing stealing. But when it comes to thoughts, I told you that you have both the civil and the criminal. When it's the criminal, is stealing. When it's torts, is trespass to chattel or conversion. Do you understand? So it depends on either one of which you're talking about. So we move on to the next one. So we have law of trust, and the law of trust is saying that, you know, when something happens, you can give a property to somebody to hold it in trust, because probably the siblings or the children are still very young. And okay, for example, a rich man had a lot of property, and then he devised in his will before he died, you know, that this property should be given to A and B. Let's say the property should be given to Adiremi and Farumbi Shey. Now those are the children. Do you understand? So they are saying hold this property. The property is to be given to them, but they are giving a third party to hold it on their behalf. Do you understand? That is commonsensical. That is reasonable, because those children cannot hold. Let's say they are okay. I know Shei and Remy is in year one, and they are probably 17. But then, even at 17, they are not legally. I am not saying that I know that they are 17. No, I'm just saying that, you know, they are likely 17. So they are year one in lag and all that. So if they are given property even at 17, they will not be able to hold that property at that age. So they have to give the property to a third party who will hold the property for them. And that is where you have the law of trust. And then you have the African Charter. You have a lot of other laws that are applicable in Nigeria. The African Charter is a charter for fundamental human rights, which is applicable in Nigeria by virtue of Section 12, and also by virtue of the case of Ghani versus Fawemi. Now, we are going into the cases. The first case I'm discussing today is the case of Garba versus University of Maiduguri. Now, the first time I heard this case was in my year two. And I was taught by Professor Oyo, the current AG of Oyo State, someone that I like so much, but that's not the point. The point here is that, you know, I always listened in his class because it was a very, very interesting lecturer, one of my very interesting lecturers. It made the case look very relatable or sound very relatable to us and all that. And also the case of Akitemi versus Ome Chidi, which was his class. But that's something for another day. So in the case of GABA versus University of Maiduguri, GABA was part of the student union government. Do you understand? GABA was part of the student union government. And if you are in UNILAG for like a long time, I've been in UNILAG for 5 years, and I know that there are some times you'll be in UNILAG, there will be no water. There will be no light. Although the DSA, that the Dean of Student Affairs, will send messages and say, we apologize for this and that, it is beyond university control, it is due to this or it's due to that, which is quite understandable, which, you know, we have to give him kudos for. But when you are talking about other universities, for example, what happened in the University of Maiduguri, there was no light and there was no water for days. And, you know, in UNILAG, when something like that happens, boys, we just have to take bag of water, like bag of pure water, and just try to wash the heartbeat and the face and all that, and then rush down to class. And you know, when there's no light, you have to leave campus, you have to go as far as outside school to go and charge your phone. They now walk outside school in the evening. Ah, guy, that thing is stressful. And then somewhere like UNILAG, where you have about in an 8-man room, you'd have like 16 people or 24 people in an 8-man room. Imagine that there's no light in the night and it's doing the heat season, guy, you are basically dead. So people just be smelling and all that. So GABA and the student union decided to protest, but they did it wrong by making it a violent protest. They were destroying properties, they were destroying vehicles. In fact, they destroyed the vehicle of the deputy vice chancellor. So now, the deputy vice chancellor just said, okay, all well and good. And they decided to take them to panel. Now, when the deputy vice chancellor took them to the panel, the amazing part of it is that the same deputy vice chancellor was the head of the panel. You took somebody to the panel, and you too head the panel. In short, GABA and the rest, they do not even need to talk too much. Just don't talk, because there's no point. Like, you don't to reason. That's where we have just laws. Just think. Does it even make sense? Imagine your junior brother at home, like, or your senior brother at home, you know, he did something that you did not like, or you did something that he did not like, then you reported to your mom or something, and then your mom now told him to judge the case. Or yes, your mom, you did something that you know your mom does not like, and then you know your mom is still going to judge the case. Your mom brought you before your father, and then your mom is still the judge, still sitting down on the panel judging you. Ah, mommy, but I've not explained my part of this story. Like, do you understand what I'm saying? You have to, that's where the principle of hear the other side comes in. That's number one. And also, you can't be a judge in your own case. Nemo judes in causa sua. You can't be a judge in your own case. And audi alteram patet. Hear the other side. Those two principles were in this case. Do you understand? They didn't hear what GABA have to say. They took the matter to court. The court held that there was no fair hearing in that case. And then through a writ of certiorari, they squashed the whole decision of the panel. So if you want to know what a writ of certiorari, not a big thing, it's just an order that the judgment of a lower court should be squashed. Either a lower court, a lower tribunal, or a lower panel should be squashed. So by squashed means it shouldn't be applicable. So that's what a writ of certiorari is, certiorari, anything. So you get the whole case of GABA versus University of Maiduguri. It's quite easy. You don't even, in short, with this explanation, you understand what I'm saying. Somebody led group of people to protest. If it was a peaceful protest, it would have been something else. But this one, it was a violent one. It destroyed a lot of properties and even the car of the VC, and then of the deputy VC rather. And then they went to panel. The same person that his car was destroyed was heading the panel and all that. And then it was held by the court that there was no principle of fair hearing, there was no nemo judex, and there was no audio trumpet. So guys,